So it's those issues that need to be put in place. And support children services and the work they're doing is with their improvement plan. We've actually located a couple of members of staff actually in the building with them who go to their team meetings and they go through their agency staff who's been upset and actually put that and got them to import it. So we've done a lot of, you know, lots of detailed work on the ground around that. And the other areas that the audits have actually improved and focused minds of those areas where we've gone into where teams have unusual levels of attendance, where actually they haven't got the reported absence and looked at those. What we will also have, and the report that actually shows by employee how many times they've been off sick, will also raise awareness as to whether something's been put in or not. So every manager should be having a discussion with their managers around the story of the individual. So where there's an individual there and there's no absence from, they will know they've been off sick. So actually that's also improving that culture of reporting. Mm. We are far more confident now than we were this time last year around the level of reporting around absence. And across a large organisation, I don't think I could say 100%, but what we can say is we're a lot more confident that it is much improved in terms of that absence. But it is culture, it is leadership, it is performance management and follow-up, which we have introduced more rigorously in terms of that reporting. In terms of the data, whilst we have the story on the reports that come out, it's also on our management system, so managers can see the list of people who have hit triggers and the list of people who have been upset.
Good like that. No, I can see I've got a few hands going up, but we have really had a fairly good series of questions. What I'd like to suggest from the chair, only suggestion, is that in view of the fact that Chris has had so many questions and contributions, might I propose that at the next meeting but one perhaps we might have a supplementary report taking into account the various questions.
Yeah, can I just make a suggestion?
I've got a rotation that people will all ask.
If you've put a proposal forward, all I would say is I couldn't agree with that proposal because that would be even longer where I think there are problems in it, and they would become in Parliament embedded in the culture. And so I would rather raise them now, where it's not yet embedded in the culture.
Can I just make just a very quick chair, thank you, for your indulgence. I think this report is, I'm only deputising tonight, I might add, but I think this report is quite alarming. And could I suggest that there's a task and finish or a workshop around this? Is that what this committee does? But I think there should be a few hours spent on this so the committee could drill down and see, because I think it's a culture.
Yeah.
There's management training issues involved in this, I would suggest. So what about a task and finish or a workshop, Chair?
That would be possible. So I would just have to bring Robin in. He hasn't said anything at all. He's sure he's had.
Thank you, Chair. So I mean, I just have a couple of very quick points, I think, and hopefully a little bit of context. I think, as my understanding, the reason that this is on the agenda today is because this was a concern about the way absence management is dealt with, raised by internal audit. So this is the sort of one of a report which looks at the response to that. And obviously, that is it's absolutely right. A lot of attention to this because it's not just the cost. It's also the impact, particularly on small teams, as you've already said, Councillor, the people that are acting up in respect to that. It strikes me that that's still work in progress. There's still more to do, clearly, in terms of that. I would suspect that in some way it must have in the plan to follow up in terms of their concerns. So we should perhaps understand the timetable for that. I think the actual rates of sickness absence, whilst clearly a concern, you might get them lower. They are about very much in the pack for similar local authorities. So I don't think we're talking about an extreme problem. But that's not to say that there isn't value that can be added from a task and finish group. So it strikes me that it's probably useful for some context that this is absolutely on the agenda because there are issues raised by internal audit. This is a sort of stop take in terms of where you've got to so far. There's clearly more to do. I think clearly there's going to be a follow-up by internal audit. So I hope that's helpful. I think just a little bit of context in terms of the discussion in front of us.
Chair, I would suggest that's not helpful at all.
Well, okay.
Why do you just bring it forward?
No, hold on a minute. bring Jeff back in.
Okay, thanks. I think a maintenance and focus on this is important. So a maintaining the focus on this is important. And whether that's the follow-up audit, whether it's responding to that in this forum, I'm sure it's not very comfortable for Chris coming along to have to explain where we are. Or whether it's employees' appointments looking at this and being able to spend a lot of time to actually drill in. And I think it might be a reference from here to employment appointments, for instance, might be a way to get something moving quickly.
I think that's a really good suggestion. Yes.
Thank you. But I do think as well, it's all very well for Chris as head of HR and OD to come along and talk about this. I think this is a head of paid service issue, actually. We have someone that we employ as a head of paid service. Yeah. This is an issue around paid service. And it strikes me that if there was that senior management push, that would help everyone else in the organisation to understand its importance. So, whilst it's great that Chris will come and tell us the figures, and no doubt right to be on the answer, she didn't get a chance to give. I think there's merit in asking the chief executive to come along to say what's being done about.
Is that a proposition?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I second that.
That's been seconded. Now, if
can I ask questions? Why does the report come to us if we're not supposed to ask questions on it?
Sorry, but we've got a proposition that's been seconded. I think we need to know debate the proposition. Is anybody against the proposition? I mean, in favour of it, that's who you're speaking for and against. Right. I think virtually everybody's in favour of that. Now, if that's the case, I think that concludes this item of business because we've now made a decision on what we want, which is a report from the paid head service.
But I think we wanted him rather than
moving
forward.
But it's more than a report, Chair.
I thought what I'd suggested was that we maintain our focus, and Mark is clearly going to do that because that's, you know, this is us doing our job. We've identified something and we're following it through. I did suggest that maybe we should go to employment and appointments for you to call for, suggest a meeting of employment and appointments, pretty quick, one would suggest, to talk this through. And that we invite the chief executive to come along to employment right. To explain what it's supposed to be.
If that was your proposition, that's clarified a little bit. I would still regard that to be perfectly what was intended. Are we happy with that?
Yes.
Do it through EMP. Okay. In that case, I'd like to say that concludes this item of business now.
Chair, I should say one thing before you conclude the business. I did have my hand up from the beginning, yeah. And I've been trying to send you ever since.
Sorry,
I haven't got a chance to. And I don't wish to now, because it's a bit late in the day.
Sorry, Liz, I really didn't know because you had hand from the beginning.
I did.
Thank you for your indulgence. Chris, you're free to go.
Thank you.
Thank you, Richard.
Thank you very much.
Pass it over to the chief executive.
Okay, we're now on to item 4, which is the internal reporting update. That's on page 11. Mark, over to you.
This is a regular report which I present to members of this committee that contains information relating to the delivery of the internal service for the period of September to the 31st. Report conflict on the identification of any items of note or items I want to escalate to yourselves for your attention or action. Provide performance data relating to the delivery of the internet audit service. Identifies the developments that are currently taking place within the service. The attention is specifically drawn to section 3.2 on page 12 of the committee papers, where a number of items are identified. One of those items concerns the RMC training that's scheduled for Thursday of this week. If I could take this opportunity to remind all members or designated deputies of the importance of this and encourage as many of you as possible to attend.
What's 1 o'clock? Can I say on that that this committee was adamant that we really did want that training?
Yeah.
I realise that sometimes clients find it very difficult to come to one day. on for the third batch of it, so if anyone that hasn't gone previously could try and come to it, it would be really good idea.
Attention is also drawn to section 3.3 of the report, page 14, where a table identifies information relating to those orders where recommended actions included in order report remain outstanding. The actual table is attached to appendix 1. You'll note that all the items currently amber rated indicating that work is in progress to address the issues. All of the items in this particular report relate to those of an ICT nature, and there is a report being presented later on the agenda by the head of digital for those items. Section 3.4, page 14 of the report, identify information that relates to the performance of the internal service. You'll note that delivery of the plan is approximately on target this time of year. Feedback from clients and managers remains very good, with the action to identify no reports being agreed, and the satisfaction level remains consistently high. 3.5, page 14, the report identifies some of the continuing improvements that have been made to delivery of the internal service. This is a regular feature of the report and is provided to demonstrate that there's an ongoing sort of actions to challenge and develop how we go about delivering the service, and to identify sort of any improvements that need to be made in what is a effectively kind of evolving the sector environment, lots of new best practice materializing almost. Happy to take any questions.
No, Les didn't have his hand, but I'll give him the first shot.
First of all, on page 12, 3.2, I don't understand why there is no compatibility with the council, the tax rate, the objective programs, and the things are. So I've forgotten. So,
This is, at the moment, it's a piece of work that's in the pipeline, really, which just relates to the fact that it is a strategic piece of work that's quite wide ranging, covering a lot of management activities, covering some of the cultural issues that you've alluded to during the course of the discussion.
So I won't be expected to know it.
Well, the report will inform you, and what I will be doing will be bringing the outcome of that report to select about the January or March meeting next year. And so it is a work in progress. I'm merely flagging it up to let you know that it's a significant piece of work, the outcome of which likely will certainly be of interest to yourselves, and will possibly prompt actions by yourself. But it's merely just to sort of
So the next one is 3.2c. We got any feedback yet on the international fraud awareness review back into that?
No, I can tell you a little bit about that now. The fourth publicity campaign was run last week to coincide with the International Fraud Awareness Week. It involved us producing posters and banners, there were internet messages, there were advertisements on various public buildings, to raise awareness, to alert sort of both members of the public and members of staff and to the threats that are out there and what this kind of threat poses in terms of the sort of finances of the organisation. It was a successful campaign in terms of the calls that we've had on the back of the campaign, lots of people inquiring about sort of what procedures they should follow and how they should go about reporting these things. There have been a number of reported incidents that have come through as well. The campaign is related to the fact that we have some very robust policies and procedures in place, we have some reporting lines. But it was merely a way of kind of engaging with and raising the profile and awareness. And as I say, it's early days, we're only two days into the following week, but already the fans are linked away, like, so I'm happy with the reaction that we've had to that. Certainly suggests that there's an interest in appetite.
I think there is, because people are getting so worried about it.
Especially
local people. 3.2D, the highways maintenance contract. Am I being naive here? Do you think that might mean that when they tell you that government will put the letter through your door, like I got telling me there's going to be two coatings on my road, and they only give me one, I think we're going to get two now, and our white and double yellow lines back? Or is that just... We get so many complaints about the letter that they send out, which says we do one and then we come back a day later and they never come back, and then councillors will all get the calls and they take really anything to do with us. And the
you're looking to get warm, Christine. You know,
sorry?
You're looking to get warm.
Well, you should see my road. It's been there 7 weeks and already it's wearing. Yeah, it's just that it said that the contractors are going to provide more clarity, so I just wondered if one of the clarities was that they actually did what they said they were doing. 3.2, the golf courses. Can you tell me which two golf courses it was, please? Because the golf course in my own ward, money is never collected. It's something I raise at every meeting I'm going to. So,
I should be able to, but I can't afford a golf course. I can, however, certainly drop you behind.
If you could, please, can we see that audit? And be very, if that audit applies to Bevington Wars, I am Bevington Wars, then I would like to see it happen.
I'll tell you what, I'm in the process of preparing the bi-monthly report, which will go to SLT next week, should be available with you by the close next week, which contains a lot more detail, including the recommendations and the rating and the relation this week.
Because I intend to go on the golf course to talk to people and ask them if they pay, because they don't pay obviously. So I talk to them about what happens when you don't pay. Right. So I'd be interested if you
I really can't say I'm on course again. Renee's something, but I will certainly.
Thank you.
Did you get everything right? You got it. Chris Tribune, then David Overton, then Andrew, and then.
Then last. Yes.
I'll deputise and go. Bear with me with the class questions. And I'm looking on page 15, you've got the number of worker. The second one to the bottom says ongoing implementation of paperless working environment. I'd like a bit more about that. Do you have any idea of the cost involved in the paperwork? Because I know as a councillor, we get loads of concerns when we produce these things all the time. I've just changed my laptop for an iPad, and I've just trialled a new application that they put on there to read all this stuff that you can annotate and stuff. And it works really well. So I'm just wondering how much of a cost implication there is to producing all this stuff and also get rid of all the stuff that once has been produced.
In response to your question, then, the initiative that we've undertaken has come about primarily as a result of sort of changes in the best practice, public sector internal best practice, which now allows us to sort of store things in electronic fashion rather than all the paperwork as evidence to support findings and outcomes. So we on the back of that determined that the response to the paperwork being sort of passed around the office. So we're in the process of sort of electrifying all of that a long way of things going forward. In terms of the committee papers that you're referring to there and the cost associated with those, I really haven't got any idea, but I know that you've been looking into
that will be us, Chair, yes.
As to whether or not we have any facts figures.
Wasn't just particularly the committee papers, it was the applicant paper and ink and printing.
I don't know, but I should certainly make some inquiries.
Thank you. Okay. Through you, Chair. In terms of committee papers, the current cost for everything all inclusive is running at about 4 pence per page. So if you look at
4 pence
per page, so 130 page agenda, plus times however many members of committee officers.
This might be the wrong time to bring it up, but there was a clear, almost a decision from a few years back, was it about 2012, that we would try to bring our laptops along so as to cut out the cost of paper almost completely?
To be fair, I think we should be working towards that, yeah. There's a process here whereby this building, for those of us who have the trial paperless, the Wi-Fi here just isn't sufficient to maintain that. For our case management system, for example, watch the little wheel go around for weeks. So it's an implementation process, but it is absolutely in our sights.
Still a little bit better, thank you. David?
Yes, mine was just a quick question relating to the one of Christina's actually. Reading this feature on the golf courses on page 30, it said, raising concern over cash security. I had visions of little people in horizontal striped jerseys with masks on, mugging people. But I assume it's nothing like that, purely the control of the way the cash is collected and administered.
and particularly as you've said, those people who go on the golf course at 6 o'clock in the morning and pay. And that's, I assume that's what we're talking about.
It's precisely that. It's the cash management systems that are in place there that include everything from the receiving of cash to through to the sort of banking.
So we don't need to worry about people in masks and stripes.
I always worry about that. not in this place.
it's tangible with theft, isn't it? Thank you. Sorry, can you give me my
quickly, while we're on the golf course. A colleague of mine just alerted me to the fact that it was a beach one hour in the park, the two golf courses that were
Bracken. It was Brackenwood, Christina.
Andrew, you have the floor.
Okay. My question's also about golf courses. So it's saying that there was two golf courses audited. I just was looking for some assurance around that, you know, that the cash management system had been looked at in these golf courses.
I think it's part of a bigger plan.
Data loss prevention, page 19. It quite rightly brought up as a major problem in the light of all the data losses that's going on, and the fact that we desperately needed the plan in place to sort that out. This committee was told at the head of digital report on January meeting that it would be completed by May 2017.
Yeah.
And there was supposed to be an update on the 30th 11th. 17 to this committee. The question is, why wasn't it completed?
The acting head of digital will be presenting a report later on the agenda and we'll be dealing with specifically this issue. The acting head has picked up on some of the stock issues that the previous head of digital had to be sort of in progress and hadn't completed for a lot of reasons, but nevertheless, the acting head should be able to find the more information to be checked.
Just through you, Chair, really I'm very grateful to Jeff for stepping up to the acting individual and his team.
Well, thanks.
You're welcome. The previous head of digital, as you know, left in quite short order. The deadlines and timings were set by him. He must have had some assumption made that he was going to get additional funding or additional people to meet those deadlines. Clearly, we're not able to do that. I'm satisfied that Jeff and his team are dealing with some challenging projects. They're on time to us, an achievable time scale, and they're being done safely, trying to minimise the disruption of the existing service. I'm very grateful for that. Clearly, by them agreeing to our government situation, we've also saved the cost of having to bring in on-site people. So I think that the time scales that Jeff cannot speak on the time scales that were there because he didn't set them, and I think they must have been done on the basis of an assumption of greater results. Because the ones that are in here now are the achievements. Just while I'm speaking, just on two small things. The golf course income has been raised with me again and again and again and again. And I go away back to my colleagues in leisure and say, why can't you just bring about this? The answer I get, whether it's right or not, is that the cost of putting somebody in place to police it from 6 o'clock in the morning would not cover the cost of the charges that they could collect. I hope all of that's
true. Sorry, they don't collect money all day.
And just to show
why do we have
three golf
days?
I don't know. That's the answer I get. I raised it about the early morning people going on the course.
It's all day.
Well, I'll take that away again. and the final thing is just came in on the end of the comment about highways and lining, because that's been an issue that I've responded to. I can tell you this is a real piece of detail, but apparently the coating we applied on some of the road surfaces, we applied coating, which has to be perfectly dry to apply the lines. And on some coatings, the machine that comes to do the lines has a big gas wand, heated wand. On some coatings, if it's raining, they can come and use the wand to dry the piece of road before they put the markings on. But on a particular micro surfacing that we've used, they can't do that. So it does literally have to wait for for dry days, and that's the other side. Because they missed three schools at the start of the term, which was crucial, and I chased one, chased one, chased one. I didn't check out the forces if we do right things.
I accept that explanation. I welcome Jeff doing the final report. I hope he doesn't walk with stress having to act up.
Next up, Mike.
My question has been answered, thanks, Jeff.
Okay, in that case, I've got Jeff.
Yeah, just a couple of things. And again, can we go, Jeff? I am particularly interested, I know this is really sad, but GDPR, so the General Data Protection Regulations, which I believe are going to be really significant and very challenging for us as a council, given the work that we do. Some reassurance that we're not underestimating that. The other thing, as David's in his helpful confessional mode, I just noticed him shaking his head. I think Christina mentioned about this being part of a plan and the selling off of Brackwood Golf Course for housing as part of a wider plan. I didn't know whether you wanted to give David the opportunity to respond to that.
Yeah, I'm very happy to say, Chair, that I am not aware of any plans to release any golf courses for redevelopment. As you know, we've worked through all the council's asset lists. We are releasing quite a collection of bits of small assets to generate capital because we have this opportunity currently, which was given to us by George Osborne, to convert capital into revenue for 3 years of fund transformation. We've looked across all our asset base to release things that are not operational for the council, where it might even be beneficial to the people who are our tenants to buy the freeholds, so it's a win-win. There are no plans to release any of the golf courses for housing.
I'm so sure.
Well, I can only speak as a capital there, aren't I?
Exactly. I'm starting with one comment.
Chairman, I can address the first point of the council agreement. As I have the joy of chairing the group that's been tasked with introducing the GDPR, it is a large group and rely very heavily on IT and audit colleagues. It is being taken extremely seriously. We've taken a report to our SLT, we're aware of the impact that the
finances can be
stating, and yes, they're very well aware of that. And indeed, we've gone so far as to know a project manager specifically.
Wow.
To lead us as a group, and it is a fairly large group, to make sure that we all do what we need to do. Those audits are done and in place. Training is delivered throughout the organisation, and that information will be cascaded. And obviously, if members of this committee want to specific reports on that, we would be only delighted for the budget.
Well, maybe I can come and see what you've got. Into it rather than having to kill a 4p shot, a big room.
I can't expert for sitting just over there, so he will be very happy to spend some time with you and put on his anorak because we enjoy those moments.
Okay, I sort of sense that we might be moving almost seamlessly onto agenda number 5.
So,
Chair,
this is suggesting that we have the report and we'd like to have.
It certainly is, in terms of the remit of this committee, Chair, a risk, a very serious risk.
So, how will we have the report? What are you proposing this year?
I propose
it's an agenda item. I think it's a good idea to have an update, isn't it? Progress.
I don't know what's been here before, Chair, so forgive me.
Okay, we all want that, that's fine. I'll try until 5 then.
That's me, Chair, to you. This report updates members on the activities of the Tenloy Fund 14 for the period 2016-17 and the year to date. The remit of the small team that operates in the high remit is to prepare relevant practice, policies, procedures, facilitate cultural change and attitudes to fraud across the council, proactively manage the risk of fraud through targeted pieces of work and audits, provide proactive and reactive response to the reports that are reported. The evaluation of the activities undertaken, including the recent capital fraud publicity campaign that we alluded to earlier, provided from section 3.7 on page 23 of the report. And at this stage, we really ask to sort of note the board activities that we involved, so that we continue to provide the
ongoing support that you've been providing for the participants. Include fraud at 6 o'clock on the golf course?
Yeah, I think this is a great report, actually, and I think it really is something we should be doing. And, you know, I think we should congratulate Mark and the team for actually getting into this. My slight concern, and maybe it's my utilising the rush, Mark, but the only bit I can see where, about cash where we recovered fraud looks like £167,000. So I'm just wondering in terms of what we're using the fraud. We could get ourselves into a virtuous circle here, couldn't we? So we could start using this team to clamp down on fraud and start bringing money back. And then we could use potentially a percentage of that recovered money to further support, develop, train the team. So we make sure that we are squeezing any fraud that we've got out of the system. But I think in order to do that, it would be really useful to see the amounts that this group is bringing in. So I don't know what your views are on that, or whether you've hidden your lights under a bushel with just this 167. But you've certainly covered your costs with 167,000 more presumably.
Anyone else on that?
This figure is purely in relation to the National Fraud Initiative work that we do. And that is quite a tangible amount of money that's very easily identified for what it is. There's a lot of other work that gets done that isn't immediately, there isn't an immediate kind of financial element to identify in terms of the work that we do to promote kind of fraud, the work that we do to raise awareness. It's difficult to put a value on that kind of work. And there's quite an extensive amount of work undertaken of that nature through the various publicity campaigns. Even the work that we do that's of a sort of proactive fraud nature, be it the examination of expenses claims forms from members or whoever, to ensure that that sort of, you know, that accuracy and validity and honesty is understand where I'm coming from. So there's a lot of that kind of work that's on the table, which again doesn't necessarily have an obvious tangible answer associated with it. So I appreciate what you say, and I think there's some merit in us to be exploring that further.
Could be, Chair. I mean, I do think, looking back to that earlier one where it said about the work that we've done, what they said, maybe the words as clear as they could have been. I read that between the lines as actually that, you know, there's something going on there, we're sorting it out. So any additional income that is generated for additional work is down to the work of your team. And equally, I think in some of these other areas, I think we should be more, you know, hard-edged if we can be, around counteracting fraud. We have a lot of people who contract with the council. And, you know, there must be, I would like the assurance that there is no fraud going on and that it is investigated rigorously. And that a percentage of whatever is regenerated, I think, should be utilised to go that extra mile. I'm not saying that's a huge team. But if you can justify increasing costs, why don't we invest some of that into further activity?
I think everyone would agree with that.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Okay. There's also a team of revenues and benefits to look at things like single person discounts as well. They've got a significant sum in there.
Yes.
Why aren't we out to people who are claiming single person discount, perhaps their own use leave, sort of generate additional income, and that's been factored into the council tax base of the council going forward. So again, we want to look at that, possibly look at it in terms of the revenues and benefits for us.
What effects are going to have on this universal fraud? Is it going to make it easier for fraud or harder for fraud to be taken from that perspective?
It's just a dog's dinner, they won't be able to answer that.
That's a question, I'll put it on record. It's an interesting point because at the moment they're dealing with lots of different areas where you have fraud in this bit and that bit can be looked for.
I think we should be clear, 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 I think we but I think it's a great idea to link it all together. So we've got a, we as a committee have got a view about the assurance we can take.
So
are
we happy on that?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
can we go
yeah,
on
that?
Thanks, Chair. This is the annual governance statement of significant government issues update.
Can I just say before we do go longer, I think Jeff Ashworth, of course, may have something to say on this. And had she been able to remain, possibly Chris Hines might have. But the reason I've been fine why I brought her to the front of the agenda is that her daughter has had a minor bump of some sort. That she is all right, but obviously Chris wanted to get away.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm sure
you
know.
Committee were aware that every year you get the annual government statement brought here. On the back of that statement is an action plan to take forward. It's been agreed that this committee gets an update every meeting about what's happening in those actions. The way it's managed to the officers are to the corporate governance group and the discussions that go on there. The appendix brings together the key issues on the back of this report, picking out the main areas, the CIT, which just represents important few minutes, the HR issues Chris has gone through in terms of the phrase until sickness, there are the issues that are around the floor, which maybe he's got an update there on doing around the recording system and the processes there, that's going to the contact. So lots of the issues are there, and I've called by such a good idea for the agenda. The one is perhaps the children's services area, which regular updates goes to the Children's Scrutiny Committee.
Yeah.
So perhaps in a moment we'll more detail on that, more details actually taken in those committees again.
So, can I just for a and again, I'm relatively new to the committee. So, is this a response to, because we've got the audit letter at the back of the pack, haven't we? So, is this in response to the audit letter? Or is this a response, this year's audit letter, is it a response to an earlier all governance statement? Just so it's unclear, because I have got a question.
It's the council's annual governance statement, the one signed by the leader and the chief executive, identified where we are and the issues we need to take going forward. And a number of items have been on there for a couple of years, particularly IT, members of the committee thought we've got IT has been on there for some time now, and procurement as well as assets management. So there's certainly care of issues. To keep them alive, so maybe not there comes to the fiscal to serve progress that would be a main issue.
Could I ask
you,
on page 3, where it says all the calendar review in the last 6 months with the exception of why is it still out there? Cemeteries have come to the story in July 2016.
Yeah, but what that means, I mean... Chair, I've just come in. The business continues as a matter of concern because the government's group of progress files. We took it away to action, and I followed up personally with each named officer who's responsible for the business continuity plan. There were two things to do, make sure they were up to date, but also make sure they're doing some kind of walkthrough test of them. So actually this is a much improved position than where we were previously. There are a small number that still outstanding, but all 26 now have actually brought themselves up to date, which is a very different position than where we were a few months ago.
So since the 7th of September, those ones that were outstanding have now been done on?
The ones that were outstanding, the dates as to when they will be done on.
No, well, this says it was due on the 16th of July 2016. Environmental Health in February 2016. CYPD in October 2015. And if they've been reviewed in the last 6 months, with that exception, are you now saying they've been done?
No, they're the ones that remain outstanding.
Well, then why has it got a rating of amber? Surely if something's not been done since October 2015, 2 years ago, over 2 years ago, it kind of is a bit more worrying than an amber.
It's just the rating of amber, it's only 1 out of 26 have been done, and there's 5 outstanding which are in progress.
But that's...
But haven't been completed yet. The pressure would be in one of those relevant sections to complete the
plan. There's nothing in here that highlights that it is a worry, and it certainly is a worry. That those haven't been done.
Please tell me if I don't understand, but my understanding is it's amber merely because it still is amber.
I think you've got to, well, the way I read it is that it's not for the individual case. So if you look at social care, especially services due atonement, the amber's not for that, the amber's for the project as a whole.
Yeah. Right, well, can I just suggest that we've got ourselves into difficulties 1 month ago because of one area, one department, and I think it's not a sensible move if we've got things as far away as that as over 2 years ago, and it's social care specialist services. I think they should be taken out of that and put somewhere red, if that's the case, because that's gone on too long. My other question is, the absence projection for the financial year is currently around 9.9 days, but we had different figures before. So from the 7th of September to now, we seem to have a huge increase in absence, is that right?
Well, Chris presented based on all today's figures. So yes, she's projected for the year what's happened. So when this was produced, it would have been fully suggested all been all the data.
Yeah.
And Chris has given you the information now, it's all the way to date, which has got all the data.
So that means it's got worse.
Hers is a projection to the end of the year, so sickness will always be higher than winter months and the summer. So
It says in the thing that it's amber if people are addressing it. It's red if no one's done anything about it. I do think, however, and I agree absolutely with Christina, and she made me look at it a bit more closely, which I did. I think if there are no business continuity plans for healthcare, supported housing, homelessness, SEN transport plan yet to be tested, I think there's a materiality issue there in terms of. You know, they were serious enough for Mark to highlight in the first place. It's great that they've done 21 and 26, welcome, but I still think there's a materiality issue that we should be reporting on the exposure. So, you know, in a way, I think it should be, I can understand why someone would say this should be highlighted as red, because we're very exposed if something went wrong in those areas. So, maybe we can review how we report on that, because I do think there's a materiality issue. It seems to be quite a big risk that still hasn't been plugged. And then finally, I know Tom said that children's services was being looked at somewhere else. Nonetheless, we did raise it at the meeting, obviously, to recall with David and other colleagues, raising the fact that this was a big issue in terms of the government statement. And a big issue and a full throttle of the standards we all want in terms of children's services, a governance issue. Also conscious that we are having our, looking at the management letter, we're having our accounts qualify, or our statement from the audit letter, the statement is being qualified because of children's services and the fact that the required level of progress hasn't been made. So I do think that as well as the children's services committee or whatever, or scrutiny committee,